Okay, so this is a talk I've given a number of times. It's specifically for people who are interested in designing games, but it also could be interesting for people who are just interested in playing different games and sort of seeing what they like in games and what they don't like. The topic is one that I'm passionate about is luck in games. How much luck should there be? What is luck? How does it affect the gameplay? Just broadly, the sort of games I'm really interested in are ones that have a lot of luck and a lot of skill. Games is a very broad category of things, and whenever you talk about games, it's important to be, I think it's important to be specific about what sort of games you're talking about, and that's because when you start talking about games in general, it gets very confusing because you start incorporating things like Dungeons and Dragons, or children's play, or game shows, or something like that, or party games, where they don't necessarily meet whatever criteria you're talking about. They're still games, but one thing I like to do is separate off ortho games, and ortho games are something which I can define. They are often what we classically think of as games, which is they're something that take a set amount of time, and they end up with the players being ranked. That ranking might be just a winner and a loser, but it also might be score. And so these are all ortho games. Basketball, you end up with one team winning, usually cards that way, Counter-Strike and so forth. But there's a lot of games which aren't ortho games, like Dungeons and Dragons. So here are some which aren't. Farmville lasts forever, and you sort of arbitrarily go up. Children's Play often isn't Dungeons and Dragons, Zelda, because it's a one-player game. These I consider games, but oftentimes, I think when you're talking about games in general, what you're talking about doesn't necessarily apply to these as easily, so you have to sort of break them off. So, these are two things you often hear when you're talking about luck versus skill. There's a complaint that there's too much luck in the game, or that there's no luck at all, the game is entirely skill. And I am going to assert that this is a false dichotomy. Luck is not the opposite of skill. There are two attributes which sort of live together in the game. So one thing I like to do when I talk about games is I make toy games. Toy games are games that you wouldn't necessarily want to play because they're not fun. But they often demonstrate, they are games, and they often demonstrate something about games. You can learn to understand games from them. And so this toy game will demonstrate that luck and skill are not opposites, at least the way we think about luck and skill intuitively. So with rando chess, you play chess, but afterwards you roll a die. So you see this poor person over here is lost. after you roll a die, if you roll a one, the loser wins and the winner loses. So now he's happy and this guy's upset. So, next one. So, rando chess, by anybody's intuitive measure of skill, has the same skill as regular chess. Because all the books on chess skill apply to rando chess. If you're better at regular chess, you're going to be better at rando chess because you only get hosed one in six times. But it obviously also has more luck. When you play rando chess, you're going to lose more often as the better player. So consequently, rando chess has both more skill and more luck than, it has the same amount of skill, by my definition of skill, which I won't go into because that's very complicated, but it also has more luck. So here's a second game, one which I'm going to claim has not much skill and not much luck. This is pick a number. Each player simultaneously exposes their hand, and whoever shows more fingers wins. Okay. There's very low luck in this game. You show your hand, And there's not much skill. The skill is show all your fingers. That's a skill. And so while rando chess has a lot of skill and a lot of luck, this has not much skill and not much luck. But you could end up with one person with more fingers than. So here's a luck versus skill graph. So part of this exercise is just, again, a lot of people view luck and skill as being opposites, and I view it as sort of in this continuum where you've got a game with low luck and low skill, which would be tic-tac-toe, and a game with high luck and high skill would be poker. One with low luck and high skill is go, and one with high luck and low skill, bingo. And games sort of live in this graph. So this begs the question, what is luck? And hopefully I explain it. So there's a lot of different types of lucks that enter a game. The most common one, which we think of as being luck, is overt randomness. And that includes dice and cards and random number generators. So all these you look at in a game and everybody says, that's luck. There's some luck there. There's some chance. Okay. There's other ways that luck gets introduced into games, though. Game theory and politics is one. This comes from simultaneous and hidden actions, typically. So rock, paper, scissors is frequently cited there. Most people have a little bit of an uncomfortable feeling when they talk about the luck in rock, paper, scissors, because on the one hand, it feels like you're entirely in control of your situation, of the results. On the other hand, it also feels like it's entirely luck. And it's kind of in between. There is some skill. There are better and worse players at rock, paper, scissors, but there's definitely luck involved. Other players in multiplayer games, like three or more player games, will often introduce luck also. So physical limitations also introduce luck. If you have to memorize a whole bunch of stuff, you might memorize it. You might come, like if you had to memorize a string of digits and you had to remember whether this was a 5 or a 4 and you knew it was one or the other, you might just guess and you're going to get lucky or not. Accuracy, let's go through these. Speed. So all these things, and there's another strength. All these things are sort of measured on a probabilistic scale when you actually play them. For instance, when studying basketball players and baseball players on what when they were on hot streaks and cold streaks for shooting baskets or hitting balls, it was found that generally these things were sort of mathematically inevitable, that it was just this person had a 30% chance to hit the ball, and they got the same number of streaks as they would have if they were just rolling dice. So it doesn't mean there's no skill. It just means that there's this component of luck. And one other form of luck that you get is complexity. So with complexity, to demonstrate that, if you had to choose behind one of these doors, which one had victory and which one was defeat, you would call that luck. So if these doors were complexity beyond your understanding, then what difference is that? So here, if you're looking at a game situation and it's so complex you can't analyze it, or you can't in the time you've got allotted to you, and so you decide, I'll take option A, it doesn't really matter that the fact that you could calculate this, you're not calculating it, and so it's a coin toss. So here's another toy game. This one is probably the least fun of them. So suppose we give you a large number, and you have 30 seconds to determine what the digit of pi that corresponds to that number is. So here we have to figure out the 50,347,200 digit of pi. And you've got 30 seconds to come up with it. So these guys are competing, okay? So they each come up with a guess. This guy's guessed 7, that guy's guessed 5. And it turns out to be seven, so this one wins. Okay? So, let's roll this. Let's go backwards. Okay, so, so here, this is the pie here is a wall of complexity, and these players are facing this wall and they're making a guess. Now, there's really no difference here than between this and playing a game of chess and not being able to see the end of the probability chain, or the end of the game tree. You're just guessing on complexity. Here, you could calculate it, but you don't have time. You don't have the hardware or software, perhaps. And so, even though this is entirely deterministic, for almost everybody, this is entirely luck. And you could also imagine, just like chess, you could become better or worse at this. Like you could memorize more digits of pi, or you might be able to come up with theories that say, you know what, in between 50 million and 100 million, there is some more odd numbers. So when you guess seven, you've got a slightly bigger chance. All those things are possible. They're all just playing with your percentage chance, your chance. And so consequently, I could be Kasparov playing randomly. If we played chess, I could just move all my pieces randomly with dice, and provided Kasparov has a game which can beat him, which they're rare, but it's been demonstrated they can, I could roll that randomly. But I've done some math, and I think I've got a better chance of winning the New York State Lottery 15 times in a row. So there's a lot of skill to that game, but there is some luck. So how I define luck is uncertainty in outcome. If you can't predict how it's going to come out, then you may as well say there's luck involved, whether that's shooting a basket or playing chess or rolling dice. And that's leads to some counterintuitive things, but we shouldn't actually be surprised that there is some counterintuitiveness here. That humans are built for finding order in chaos and finding patterns. We're very good at that, and sometimes we get confused by thinking there's a pattern, but there isn't actually. So a demonstration of that is this exercise, which is often used in probability classes, where a student is asked to generate 100 tosses of a coin, and they're supposed to just write heads, heads, tails, heads. And then they're supposed to genuinely demonstrate one with coin tosses. And generally, the person administering this test can tell which one is fake and which one is genuine easily. People who are generating the coin tosses tend to alternate more often between heads and tails and not get enough streaks. Like they look at long streaks here, like heads, 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 and say, oh, that's crazy, that couldn't happen. And so their one will not have that. It will be much more heads, tails, heads, tails, heads, heads, tails, right? And so that's what you look for in your students' simulation. And so I gave this test actually to my son, and he failed. And I gave this test to my daughter. And as a side note, when she was four, I was playing all sorts of games with her to sort of because it was a lot of fun to play these dice games and card games and memory games with her. But the one thing I found that I couldn't play with her was bluffing games. I would try to play these bluffing games, but she was just too easy to figure out. And so I made this game where she would hold a coin in her hand and then hold out her hands and tell me which one. She had to say, this one has the coin. And I could always figure out which one it was. But then after a certain point, something changed. She was able to hide which one was the real coin. So consequently, she has this understanding of bluffing, which is beyond most kids. Skylar, my son, still complains that I didn't give her the same lying training. Anyway, she fooled me. So then this brings up how you should use, this leads to how we should use luck as game designers. So, historically, one of the reasons we should question this is because historically, game designers are not professional. Games have been sort of evolved rather than designed. And so you see this in games like poker or chess. Finding the author of the game is hard, and it's because the community sort of evolves it, and some people come up with innovations, they either catch on or they don't. One thing that falls out of that is whenever people start playing more and more seriously, then they start making game changers which reduce the luck in the game. Okay, so I know what I'm going for here. So this here is a picture of Chaturanga, which is the one of the earliest forms of chess. I think it's the earliest one I know. And this actually involved dice, right? So you four people played and you rolled to see whether you could move your knight or your pawn, and you played basically a chess-like game. And so at one point. The dice were removed from the game. It was actually gamble, trying to get away from games of chance, and these two sides collided, and so luck was reduced over the ages. Similarly, with backgammon, there's been many times that luck has been reduced in backgammon, and one of them is the doubling cube, which greatly increases the skill of backgammon. And what's this? This is people playing cards. Maybe it's bridge. Bridge evolved out of whist, and again, you get this sort of historical chain of games sort of introducing more and more skill, reducing luck. If you look at the history of bridge, one of the interesting things is the introduction of a duplicate bridge. And in duplicate bridge, which is something that if you haven't played bridge, this will attract you to bridge. It's where you actually play the same hands as other people have played, and then you compare your results. So in some ways, at a superficial level, this like removes all the luck. Of course, we've just gone through luck 101 and realized that hasn't been the case because there's uncertainty in the outcome. But it does greatly reduce the amount of luck. Magic, what's that? In Magic, luck has been reduced over the ages too. When it was first released, there weren't mulligan rules, and the cards were a lot swingier. And so, as the game is taken more seriously as a competitive game, there's this incentive to reduce the amount of luck in the game. So games tend to evolve as opposed to be designed, and they tend to evolve towards less luck. It's very difficult to add luck to an existing game, and that's because the existing audience likes the way they're rewarded, right? The good players are getting a lot of accolades, and adding luck is going to reduce them. So they don't like seeing their knowledge of the game trivialized, or their expertise of the game trivialized by sometimes losing. Rando chess is an abomination, but it would be regarded as a super abomination by somebody who's good at chess. They don't want to win some of the time, they want to win all the time, right? They don't want to share any of the victories. So that makes it difficult to add luck to an existing game. So what can you get out of luck? Luck in a game can increase the variety. So, for instance, in chess, people study openings, and in fact, it's they'll play many turns in a game before they even get to a position that's interesting. It's easily possible to get caught in strategic ruts playing games with low luck. So games with high luck, higher luck, oftentimes you will get thrust into situations which are unusual, because even though neither player is playing for it, something happens. Yeah, so that's a very peculiar picture. this is a very unusual chessboard situation. This is actually my favorite chess puzzle. If you haven't seen this, I might be able to explain it to you later. But this is a very, very unusual position. Let's go. Broadly, I like to divide players into two categories. I've recently added a third category, so I might update this. But there's innovation, and then there's honing. So players who like to innovate are in Magic, they're the deck builders. And then the honers are the people who take those decks and then they play them better. And some people obviously can combine both these abilities, but some people really what they like to do is come up with the fresh concepts, but they're not necessarily the best people in the world at playing them. And other people like to refine them. So innovators tend to like to play new games because when they play these new games, there's all these fresh strategies to explore. But then once the honers get in, they start refining these strategies and playing and perfecting, shaving the percentages off. And so that's how I divide my players. Higher luck games will tend to satisfy the innovator for longer because the novel situations they're looking for that they can innovate around will occur more. And so, in continuing on this theme of what luck can offer in terms of variety, you can also use luck in the setup, which has been done in Dominion quite successfully. And that effectively increases the luck, because as you throw out this new game state, you hit something which you wouldn't necessarily have hit if you were beginning from just no cards at all and just proceeding as a traditional game would. To demonstrate this, to sort of illustrate how this might be used in actual game design, if you think of a real time strategy game, so they're StarCraft, say, the premier these days, the winner of the real-time strategy battle. These games, if you have randomized prices or technologies, that would increase the luck in the game, and I think it would often increase the variety. So let's see how that might happen. So without the randomness, the community may decide the entire game is about the tanks. And then the entire community is going to build tanks. And whether or not they're right, tanks will dominate the community because the best players are playing them. And if you, as an innovator, think that may not be the right move, if they're really good players, you may not be able to try your other strategy and have it successful because the best players in the world are playing tanks. But, and so the game might stagnate. With randomness, though, dragons might occasionally be the best choice, even for the person who thinks the tanks are almost always the best choice. So if these prices are different, there's going to be some line which is going to take people out of their strategic ruts, and will introduce variety to the game. And one of the most... this always excites me, this idea that Bobby Fischer... Grandmaster in chess has considered, introduced, and advocated a randomized chess starting position in order to break people out of the strategic rut of always having the same back ranks. He was top level chess player was very much an innovator. At the same time, most top level chess players, to be a top level chess player, you have to be both an innovator and a honer. But is much more on the honing side. He was very much an innovator, and he was offended that so much of the game was about memorizing these opening positions and building off of them. And so he advocated randomizing the back ranks symmetrically, so the white back rank here is the same as the black back rank here. So it's still a fair game, but then this would break people out of the rut of. The opening moves. So, here's another reason to add luck. Luck can protect egos. And that's because losing can be painful. And thinking you got unlucky is more satisfying to many players than thinking you were too slow or too weak or too stupid. So ideally, sort of your best state for a game is that players, when they do well, they think they did it by their own skill, but when they do poorly, they think they failed because of luck. This makes everybody happy. And then when they're more mature players, they will understand that that sometimes they won but got lucky in the process, and sometimes they lost spite or skill. So this is probably, for me, the most important element of adding luck to a game, which is that your luck can broaden your audience. In a game with low luck, it's difficult often to find the appropriate player. So for instance, with chess is a low luck game, and if you want to find somebody who's going to give you a satisfying game in and game out, you have to find somebody who's approximately the same rating as you, and it's a high skill game, and so that way if you find somebody who's a bit better than you, you will feel often like you're going to lose perhaps more often than you want to. If you find somebody who's a bit worse than you, you will find that you will perhaps not have a challenge. So here my icono guy has got many too easy people and too hard people, but the perfect person's right over there and it's hard for them to find. So, this is not, historically, this is a huge issue. Historically for games, this is a huge issue. It's one of the reasons why a game like chess is sort of a locus point for skilled players, or Go. It's because if you're going to have a skill game, you better have a lot of people playing it, because that way you can find the appropriate level skill. With the computer, you're helped a lot because the computer can help you find appropriate levels of skill. But it's easy to take this too far, because you don't necessarily just want to play anybody. Like, you might not want to play this guy. You want to play with your friends and family. And people, yeah. So will my girlfriend play Call of Duty with me? And she will if I'm lucky. She will. But there's a great chance that she'll play Mario Kart, or Settlers of Catan, or whatever that is, Super Smash Brothers. All these, or poker. All these games have more luck and are more broad. So often with low luck games, players who've invested different amounts of time will have trouble playing together. So, I'm an advocate of designing luck into games and paying a lot of attention to it, but there is an argument to be made for that games over time should reduce the amount of luck. Because as the audience matures, they will appreciate the subtleties of the game more, and they don't need this ego protection and so forth. I think, in fact, I go through this point by point. Yes, they need a crutch for their ego less, because they're already invested in the game, there are experts floating around, they've been told what's good and what's bad in the game, players, oftentimes at the beginning of a game, the difference between a beginner and an advanced player is vast. But as a game matures, that narrows, because there's this skill curve where you ramp up quickly and often it logarithmically tapers out. And so you get this situation much more often where you've got a lot of people you can play against, so matching isn't as important. And so the for the existing audience then, oftentimes you don't want to add luck to the game, or you may want to reduce the luck to the game because that will satisfy the existing audience. The only risk there is that you may keep out new players. One of the most, this is probably the end of the talk.
Yeah.
One of the most, but this concludes with a really strong point part of the luck. I wrote an article for this computer game developer magazine, which covered basically what I've just talked about. When they were working on Team Fortress 2, I don't know, has anybody here played it? It was an outstanding game. They were developing this, and the lead designer of it was Chris Green, who actually was the lead designer for Magic Online. And that's how he sort of became my friend. And he read this article and shared it with his team, and they decided to add luck to Team Fortress, which I wouldn't necessarily have recommended because of all these things, which I outlined in the article and I just outlined to you, which is that oftentimes for an existing audience, adding luck is hard to do and not necessarily the best thing, because even though Team Fortress 2 is a new game, it's in an existing genre where people expect certain things of first-person shooters. So for those of you who haven't played Team Fortress 2, it is a first-person shooter. But when they read this article, they decided to give it a shot, and what they did was they added a critical hit system. And this critical hit system made it so that sometimes when you hit, you just did a lot of damage. And it didn't tell you that there was a crit. When it was released, they did, but in the playtest, they didn't. It just randomly would... Sometimes you shoot somebody and do a lot more. And they said in the following weeks, they had all sorts of feedback from the players that the game had gotten a lot more fun. They didn't know what the secret sauce they added was, but it was terrific. And so then later on, they added this thing about when it says crit, 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 and you would be able to see when you got the crits. And then predictably, the entrenched, hardcore shooter fan said, this game is ridiculous, too much luck. And the more casual players still liked it a lot. They released it this way, and it was very successful. They felt like it was it really did the job. 2 years later, they started to actually back off of that and reduce the amount of crits reduce the amount of luck in the game. And I asked them whether they thought it was because of that. They thought it was a failure. They said no. They think it was exactly what they intended to do, which was. It really broadened the audience, brought people into the game, but now as a consequence of the game audience maturing, they weren't taking in as many new players. This was catering to their existing audience, which had become more sophisticated and wanted less luck, which is that part is what I would have predicted. So there you go. Is there nothing else? Okay. I don't know if that's what you expected. This is when I talk, I usually talk on there's a variety of game design topics I usually talk on. For Magic player audiences, they probably are more interested in a talk on the history of Magic or something like that. But that's not usually what I talk on, so I didn't. depending on how much time we've got, we've got 20 minutes, I'll take questions on this or on Magic and anything else you want to talk about.
Yeah. You said there might be three player types, innovators, owners, and you didn't mention the third one.
I think I've actually added two more that I've begun to think about. A lot of people play to get in sort of one of them I know, which is a lot of people play to get into sort of the flow, sort of a meditative state. They understand the game and they're not. So the innovators and honers comes from this point of view that everybody's always playing to improve their play, which is just not true. A lot of people are. Some people are just playing just to have fun. When I play hearts, I've played a lot of hearts. I've been an innovator. I'm mostly in games an innovator. I've been a small degree of a honer in my hearts games. But typically when I play hearts now, I'm flowing, which means that I'm exercising a skill, and it's fun to exercise a skill which I'm good at, but I'm not necessarily doing either. I'm not innovating, and I'm not honing, I'm just playing. Innovator and honer were sort of bookends at flowing. It's spectating. Spectating is the other. Some people, so I see innovators and honers as being like this. Right? You can be both, but really they're sort of the people who are actively trying to improve the game are typically innovating or honing. The people who are more exercising the game and sort of enjoying that part of it they're either in the flow state where they're trying to where they're exercising a skill and enjoying that, or they're spectators. And this is something which I kind of like. I haven't really thought this through a lot, but I think a lot of people just want to do crap to see what happens in games. and so I've seen. I mean, there's a lot of games like Munchkin or you know these random things where the people are just constantly doing things. They're not innovating because there's really not much to innovate. They're not honing their skills, and they're not even enjoying exercising a skill they're good at. They're just doing random stuff and sort of seeing what happens, and that's enjoyable. And they're the sort of players who, when there's a card out there that does something really wacky and you can't predict it, they'll do it because they want to see what happens. And so those are my four categories: innovators, honers, flow state, and spectators.
How would you reduce luck in games that would only involve the dice in the first place, except like a war hammer or a war machine? Like, what would be the formula trying to reduce the luck in just the die rolls?
Reducing luck in die rolls, well, you can do. There's a number of different approaches, and you'll have one has to play with them to sort of see what fits the best. But oftentimes, reducing luck in die rolls involves like you can flatten the luck a lot by adding a deck of cards. So in Settlers of Catan. Some players like to do that, where instead of rolling the dice each turn and thus risking having a game where you roll lots and lots of snake eyes, you play with a deck of cards which is 1-1, 1-2, 2-1, and so you've got a very flat distribution, and you play with that. So that'll reduce the luck a lot in Settlers of Catan. In a game like Warhammer, you could do something similar, but you could also do something where you are rolling more dice, but you've got more hit points. And so the more dice you're rolling, the more the law of averages will flatten out your results. So a game like, I don't know if you've ever played Titan, Fantasy Flight recently came out with a new version of Titan, which is quite nice. Titan has an immense amount of dice, but those dice, there are so many dice that actually it's reduced a lot of luck in the game because the law of averages, there's just a lot of dice being rolled, and you tend to get more average rolls. Yeah.
What was the last Magic set you worked on, and what would be the next one?
The last Magic set I worked on was Innistrad? Is that a set? when I worked on it, it didn't have a name. Had like hook, line, and sinker or something stupid like that. and so when the cards come out, I often don't recognize. Also, the cards I work on usually get distributed out among a lot of stats. But I think Innistrad was that last year?
Yeah.
So I think that was the one. So I worked on that 2 years ago, and then it came out last year. And the next one will probably be next year. Every few years, I want to work on one. I know, it was the one where you had your card backs, the cards you flip over. Yeah. So we spent a lot of time working on how to get that to work. How did that work? Did that work okay?
Really well. Yeah.
Was it a pain in drafts?
Yes.
For like 5 minutes, it was
They probably had to change the rule like 2 or 3 times on how you handle those cards.
Yeah.
But it was worth it.
I think the general consensus, even among competitive play, was that even the people who were most scared of it had to kind of begrudgingly admit it worked out okay.
Yeah, that's good to hear.
And it was fun.
Certainly they were fun to play with in the design state. Innistrad, and maybe next year I'll work on a set. Yeah.
When you first made Magic, I remember hearing stories about the cards were more swingy, obviously. You didn't expect people to buy that much of it. When you first made it, what did you really think would be the top end so that someone would spend on that game? Like, realistically.
Realistically?
20 years ago, would you?
20 years ago, my exercise for deciding whether, I mean, like, there were a lot of cards out that were broken, and most of them we knew were broken because we had 2 years... 2 years of play before the players actually got it. So there was a lot of time, a long time where we felt like we were really on top of the game. And so the question was, does is Black Lotus a problem? And the calculation was that in a play group where people aren't buying many cards, it really isn't that much of a problem. Somebody will have a Black Lotus, they'll have one of them, it'll come up sometimes, and then they'll be able to get this early advantage out. But a land stays there forever, Black Lotus just gives you this boost, and if the rest of the deck is not really working too well, it's a short-term advantage, long-term disadvantage. It's not too bad. We knew it was a problem if somebody got lots of Black Lotuses. And so the calculation was, well, everybody in your playgroup, suppose your playgroup was enormous, suppose it was, I said, 20 people. And everybody in it bought an enormous amount. So this gets to the answer to your question.
Yes.
What did I think was an enormous amount? Five decks. Five decks. How many Black Lotuses would be floating around this playgroup? And we did the calculation. If one person ended up with a lot of them, it wouldn't have been that big a deal. And the footnote to that was we decided that if that turned out to be incorrect, like that we were wrong about those estimates, that we would have a problem, but we would be very well off from selling so many cards. We could solve that problem later, which is what happened.
A bit of magic traditions.
To continue off of that, Magic is, or at least when it first came out, felt like a pretty unique proposition in that it was a game that had a continuous business model attached to it. How much was that business model a major factor in the designing of the game? And if it was a new thing to you, I don't know if it was a new thing to you, but what were you looking at that convinced you to go in that direction?
When I was working on Magic, I was not thinking in terms of business models. I was thinking in terms of what really excited me as a game player. And what excited me as a game player was having a large amount of variety, so large that it wasn't even contained in my playgroup, that there was this world out there of cards to sort of explore that I wouldn't know all of. And in fact, when Magic first came out, we didn't publish card lists and things like that, because we sort of wanted to keep that open-ended mystery about it. And that fits well with the business model, but that wasn't what I was thinking about. And to really drive that point home, what we were planning was that the first set of cards, when it came out, we would print that for a year, and then we would come out with Ice Age, and those wouldn't even mix with each other. So I was picturing it as something where it was an ongoing proposition, but I was still thinking of it in terms of the, in many ways, different games. Like different games, the same game with different environments that would be have a lot of variety. And it wasn't until it really came out that and in fact a lot of this came from players demanding that, like, Arabian Nights have the same card back, so it could be mixed freely and so forth. And that really worried me, because that was really, really hard to play test. We play tested the original set for 2 years, and Arabian Nights was designed in a matter of months and play tested months, but barely. I felt really uncomfortable with that level of play. Anyway, the point is that I was thinking about what excited me most as a game player, and that happened to marry itself well to this ongoing business model, and so that's not where I was aiming, but that's where it ended up. Did I answer your question? I feel like I got lost along the way. Yep.
So, how do you feel about the competition between the catalog and the board game? Do you find yourself
I'm really fascinated by where digital games are going, and as a designer, I'm very frustrated with them. That's because, 10 years ago, I began really working hard on trying to get new revenue models involved in digital games, and also getting new styles of digital games going, ones that were more like paper games. Like when you play something like StarCraft or Quake, these feel almost more like simulations. They're very, very different than playing something like Scrabble or Magic, which feel like games. And so I wanted to see more games designed for a computer that felt like traditional games. So 10 years I work on that, and I've gotten lots of games accepted by different companies, and they didn't know how to analyze them, like how are these revenue models going to work? These games don't exist. And now I'm with mixed emotions. I see that there's like, well, there's lots of revenue models now because of the freemium. The Asian model freemium has come over, which is sort of one of the things we're advocating, and also the Facebook platforms. And then there's lots of games which are now incorporating more traditional games. And so I feel like I kind of wasted my time for the last 10 years working on that, but I'm really excited to see it happen. Which do I find myself playing more? I really enjoy seeing the new stuff that's coming out digitally that is in this space of where it feels like a board game, but isn't. And I also like seeing traditional games put on the computer. Like one of my favorite games of the last year is Ascension. And the only reason it ranks as my favorite is because they've got an amazing iPad app. And it's really just the same game, but the fact that I can find a game any time of the day or night, I don't have to shuffle the damn cards. I can just whip out these games time after time again. It's like nothing's ever going to replace paper games because getting around the table and playing with people you know is and being able to read them across the table as opposed to guessing what's going on at the other end of the bit stream. That's something you can't really replace. But on the other hand, you've got things which are being offered by computer that are great. And so I like them both. I'm interested in the computer games these days because they're fresher, but I still play paper games and love them. Yep.
Question for you, Dr. Garfield. At the inception of Magic in 1993, I wanted to ask you, honestly, how long did you think then that the game would be viable for?
I thought Magic did vastly, vastly more successful than I thought it was going to be. And, I mean, it's still surprising. But I actually did think there was a chance that Magic could be a permanent game, right? Like games are this wonderful medium where the ones that are successful, the ones that are really good, do last forever. I don't really worry about if people stop playing Scrabble. Scrabble's just an amazing game. Poker, right? They may wane and rise in popularity, but you can. A person can play these games for their entire life and be satisfied. And I knew Magic had that sort of depth, but I also knew we'd have to be lucky in order to get to reach that. It was much more successful than I'd hoped, but I did think that it could be that sort of game. One of the reasons that I include in for that was that my playtesters, they complained a lot about a lot of decisions I made, and they said that whatever, you know, I would have one group of playtesters that would say, whatever you do, if you choose this option, it's going to ruin the game, and the other set of playtesters would say, if you do that, if you don't do that, it's going to ruin the game. And no matter what I chose, like, some people would complain and some people wouldn't, but they, and some people would say, now I hate the game. But they were still playing it like 12 hours a day. So I really knew there was something there. I'm sorry? No, I probably, even though I had this secret hope that the game would be an everyday game like a Scrabble or a Bridge or a poker, even with that, I did not expect it. Certainly not so fast to this level where it's got the representation and sort of following the past.
Yeah. Do you think the inclusion of dice in Star Wars games is a mistake retroactively?
There are a lot of Star Wars games. Is this the Star Wars game that I designed?
Yeah, the one you designed, yes, that's not it.
That's the one. Maybe, I don't know. There were so many issues surrounding the Star Wars games that it's really hard to separate what lent to us not being a great success. For me, the game was a lot of fun, and I think it had some sort of unique things going for it. But and so I. If pressed, I would say, no, I don't think it's a mistake, but if somebody gave me a bunch of evidence, I wouldn't be terribly surprised if I would have to concede, I guess it was a mistake.
Okay. Where do you think, as a game designer, where do you think the area where there's the most possibility of innovation, considering there's so many games being developed now with access to Facebook and access to streaming tech things and
there are so many games out there that it really is hard to stand out. I would say that one of the places that there's a great opportunity for, which Magic players are in an excellent position to capitalize on, is there's very few expandable games that feel like they give you what I attempted to do with Magic, and strove for, and sometimes I think it succeeded, is where getting extra cards gives you, as I tried to make it so it gives you an advantage, as little advantage as possible, but as much variety as possible. And so you get this sort of utility payback for getting extra cards, where getting the first few decks is very valuable, but then as you get more and more, it tapers off. Facebook games and most of these expandable sort of games where you get lots of things don't really touch on that at all. What they do is they're just strictly power. And so I think there's a lot of game design opportunity for people who want to introduce it so that that the game is a lot of fun for people who invest little. And on computer games, I would make that, of course, free. So you get a lot of value there, but the person who really likes the game can increase the amount of variety they get. That's the area.
You mentioned that the original playtesters went back and forth on different rules with you. What were some things in the original conception of Magic that you went back and forth on and could have gone either way in your opinion?
Well, there were a bunch of reefer cards, cards which were considered reefer cards, like Mind Twist, where cards which make your opponent discard cards, and Land Destruction. These made really, really annoying decks. And so some of my players thought that those mechanics shouldn't be in the game at all, and other ones thought that in order for the game to have any dimension, those had to be a viable part of the environment. I sided with the people who thought that they had to be a viable part of the environment, and in the beginning, they were set much more aggressively than they are now, because playing against a discard deck that is super effective isn't very much fun. But at the beginning, people weren't as good, so it was harder to get those super effective discard decks. So that's an example. Another example where I was cards which permanently... I don't think there's much of a chance I would have gone the other way here, but I did seriously consider cards which permanently exchange cards between players. Like there was a card, Eco Ship, where you take all your land in play and you take all your opponent's land in play and you shuffle them all together and you distribute. So if you have five and I have three, I'll get back three, but they'll be random lands. And Pixies, where I hit you and now if I do damage to you, we swap a card between our hands. So cards which actually change ownership between your cards. Those we played with, and some players liked them, but in the end, I decided they were not good, because you really want people sort of playing for the same role, and so like that, it was annoying playing against people who didn't really care whether they won or lost; they just wanted to hit you with the Pixies and steal all the rare cards. people would beat them a lot, but then they would leave with this bad taste in their mouth. So eventually, the Pixies had to go.
That's a kid, this guy here.
Okay. Okay. So that's all I got time for, apparently. Yeah. if